Good evening, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Doval, sir. The topic for my talk is bone health in lung cancer. And some of the aspects have already been alluded to by Dr. Doval and Dr. Amish. So let me take you through the lung-specific details, lung cancer-specific details. We know that there are these five defined skeletal-related events which can happen in cancer patients who have bone metastasis, and these can lead to disabling consequences. They can also decrease the survival in these patients. For non-small cell lung cancer, it has been reported that there could be 50% shorter survival in patients with skeletal related events compared to those who don't have these events. Almost 40% of patients with metastatic lung cancer of patients with lung cancer do develop bone metastasis during the course of their illness. And the percentage of patients with lung cancer who develop this is even more significant, because the mean number of skeletal related events per patient per year could be as high as 2.7. Just give me a minute. This slide is not moving. Okay. So these bone metastases are more of a concern now in 2020, because the improvements in treatment have resulted in significant improvement in the survival of patients with lung cancer. It has also been reported in these three large studies, which are mentioned here, that the most common skeletal related event is the need for radiotherapy, mainly for bone pain control in these patients. Now, the approved bone targeted agents in our oncology practice are these three classes of drugs, and I'll limit my talk to mainly zoledronic acid, a bisphosphonate, and denosumab, which is RANK ligand inhibitor. So these various oral and IV bisphosphonates have been studied for their efficacy in patients with lung cancer. And only zoledronic acid has stood the test of time in terms of reduction in the incidence of skeletal-related events. So this was an important study which was published in the journal Cancer in 2004 by Rosen et al. And it studied the efficacy of zoledronic acid compared to placebo in lung cancer and various other solid tumors. Lung cancer in this study was the large proportion of patients. Both non-small cell and small cell lung cancer patients were included. And it was found that zoledronic acid was effective in reducing the SREs compared to placebo significantly in both non-small cell and small cell lung cancer patients. The median time to first SRE, time to first pathological fracture, and also the time to first need for palliative radiation for pain control were all superior in the zoledronic acid arm compared to the placebo arm. So zoledronic acid was effective in the overall subgroup of solid tumors, and also specifically in those with non-small cell lung cancer. It also reduced further SREs in those with a history of prior SREs. Zoledronic acid reduced the subsequent SREs compared to placebo. This study also looked at the effect on the survival, the overall disease progression, and the death. However, no significant difference could be found compared to placebo with zoledronic acid. Now, an important question is, are all these patients with bony metastasis the same, or is there a difference? So an attempt has been made to look at the various biochemical markers, and the most commonly used and most useful one found till date is the marker of resorption, namely serum or urinary levels of N-kilopeptide. So an attempt was made in this study by Coleman et al., published in JCO in 2005. They categorized the patients into three levels of N-kilopeptide levels: 0 to 50, 50 to 100, and more than 100 in various patients with solid tumors. They found that the elevated level of N-telopeptide were associated with increased risk of bad clinical outcomes compared to the control arm. So there was more incidence of SREs, more disease progression, and higher death rate in those who had N-telopeptide level of more than or equal to 100. It was subsequently found that zoledronic acid could normalize these levels, the elevated levels, in majority of patients, not only lung cancer, but overall in all other solid tumors as well. Now, this normalization of the elevated N-telopeptide levels was further associated with improvement in survival. So those patients, if you look to the left side of yours, the levels, if they reduced from initial high level to normalized levels of N-telopeptide, the outcome was better in lung cancer. There wasn't any significant difference between zoledronic acid and the placebo arms if the baseline levels of this marker were normal. However, in patients who had high levels of baseline N-telopeptide, the survival did improve with addition of zoledronic acid compared to placebo. The risk of death was also enhanced. The survival was significantly improved with zoledronic acid compared to placebo, with 43% risk reduction in the risk of death. Subsequently, a meta-analysis was published by the same author, Coleman, and it found that zoledronic acid was in fact superior in terms of survival compared to placebo. Now, does it have any direct anti-tumor activity? And the answer seems to be yes, initially based on the murine model, and subsequently in a clinical study of patients with stage 4 non-small cell lung cancer with bone-only metastasis, zoledronic acid was combined with chemotherapy compared to the other arm of chemotherapy alone. And it was found that the overall survival and the time to progression were both superior in the combination of chemotherapy and zoledronic acid arm. Thus, to summarize, bisphosphonates, mainly zoledronic acid, do help in reduction of risk of SREs in patients with lung cancer with bone mets. Normalization of bone turnover marker, namely N-telopeptide, does lead to improvement in the outcome and improvement in the survival in lung cancer. Zoledronic acid is the only bisphosphonate to show anti-cancer benefits in different tumor types, including lung cancer, by various proposed mechanisms, namely reduction in the angiogenesis, tumor angiogenesis. It also affects the anti-tumor immune response in some ways and directly decreases tumor growth, invasion, and subsequent metastasis. Coming to the second agent, that is denosumab, a monoclonal antibody, basically a RANK ligand inhibitor, as Amish alluded to. So this agent has also been studied and compared with zoledronic acid, and this was an important paper published in JTO in 2012, which compared denosumab with zoledronic acid in non-small cell and small cell lung cancer patients. Both the groups, consisting of 411 and 400 patients respectively, were well matched in regards to the baseline characteristics, and this study reported an improvement in the overall survival with the denosumab. The OS was reported to be 8.9 months compared to 7.7 months with significant p-values. The non-small cell lung cancer subgroup in this study benefited with 9.5 months median OS. The small cell lung cancer, the figure seemed superior. However, the p-value wasn't significantly different. Different histological subtypes, namely the squamous and adenocarcinoma of NSCLC, both seem to benefit from denosumab. However, a more recently published study published in 2018, the SPLENDOR trial of denosumab in lung cancer, this trial did not show improvement in the overall survival in advanced NSCLC. The overall survival, in fact, was 8.2 months in the denosumab compared to 8.8 months in the patients who received chemo with best supportive care. Now, there have been these three randomized trials also, which have looked at this comparison of denosumab with zoledronic acid. And these studies, the combined data, the primary endpoint was time to first on-study skeletal related event. And this reported 17% reduction in the risk of SRE, the first SRE with denosumab compared to zoledronic acid. And all the solid tumors, namely the breast and prostate in particular, along with lung and other solid tumors benefited with 19% risk reduction in the lung and other solid tumor subgroup. And the first and also the subsequent SREs were reduced in the denosumab arm. There was also an attempt in another study to look at the quality of life, and it was found that quality of life was maintained in a little better way in the denosumab group compared to the zoledronic acid group. Coming to the safety aspects, we are all aware and have experienced that acute phase reactions are more often seen with the zoledronic acid. In this study, reported to the tune of 20% compared to only 8% in the denosumab arm. Hypocalcemia is a bigger issue with the denosumab, can occur in about 10% of patients. Osteonecrosis of jaw is an issue with both the agents to seemingly equal extent. So is denosumab safer than bisphosphonates? The answer can be given in mainly three factors, that denosumab does not require any dose adjustments regardless of the renal function. So this is a big advantage. The osteonecrosis of the jaw, denosumab 1.8%, zoledronic acid 1.3%, this is at end of 3 years, is not significantly different. Acute phase reactions are, as I already said, are more with zoledronic acid, but are manageable. So this is the ESMO practice guidelines that Amish also mentioned about. And these do guide us. And to summarize, from efficacy, convenience, and renal health perspectives, denosumab is the preferred agent, not only in breast cancer, as Amish said, but also in lung cancer and various other solid tumors. However, again, from a health economic perspective, generics of zoledronic acid may and are actually currently more cost effective. There's an interesting phenomenon reported with denosumab discontinuation, and that is rebound osteolysis, which has been reported mainly in those who are getting it for osteoporosis. However, this is not an issue with bisphosphonates and can in fact be reduced with the use of zoledronic acid and other bisphosphonates. Now, it's recommended to start a bone-targeted agent in majority of our patients as soon as bone metastases are diagnosed, whether the patient is symptomatic or not. And they should normally continue indefinitely, they say, even including into the hospice setting. However, treatment may be interrupted in selected group of patients who have oligometastatic disease and are perceived low risk for bone complications and have had durable response to the systemic treatment. Patients must have a dental evaluation, and also complete invasive dental treatments must be completed before initiating a bone targeted agent. This may not always be possible in our practice. It's also very important to correct any vitamin D deficiency, and if needed, use vitamin D supplements while the patients are being planned for these kind of bone targeted agents, and also maintain normal serum calcium, monitor serum calcium, and maintain normal calcium during the treatment with these agents. So I'll end my talk here.